Okay, so thank you everyone for coming here. I'm going to talk about smooth causal patches, a slightly cryptic title, and I hope to make this more clear as we go along. Before I should just give some references and collaborators. So this is based on a paper I put on the archive a few months back, and it's based on several other papers that I've written with Kyriakos Papadimas mainly, and one other paper we had with Kyriakos and Shavik Banerjee, who's a postdoc at Groningen, and Jan William Bryan, who's a student at Groningen. And I'll also make some contact with Sudeep's talk, which some of you heard a couple of days earlier. So let me just try and give you the context for this talk. So the context for this talk is really the information paradox. And one thing I would like everyone to get out of this at the end of this talk is that in its modern and most precise version, the information paradox really turns into a question of, can holography describe the interior of a black hole? So we all believe, and we have various reasons to believe, that gravity and quantum gravity is a holographic theory. And really the question is, you know, can you describe the interior of a black hole in a holographic setup? And I want to point out, and one thing I'll try and persuade you, is that this is really the version of the information paradox that we should be thinking about. And one more thing to realize, which is maybe unusual, is that in this version of the information paradox, we are not restricted to talking about evaporating black holes. In fact, the sharpest versions come about when we think about thermodynamically stable black holes in anti-de Sitter space, which are black holes which don't evaporate. Or if you like, you know, they evaporate, but the Hawking radiation bounces off the boundary and re-enters the horizon. And so these black holes are thermodynamically stable. They have classically, they have an infinite life. Okay, so now just to mention, this is also what some of you would have heard called the firewall proposal. So you might have heard a discussion about the firewall in the literature, but really the firewall is this statement. It's a question of whether you can describe the black hole holographically or not, and in AdS. So in a sequence of papers with Kyriakos, we described a resolution to this. And a description of the interior of the black hole holographically. And a key property that I want to focus on here is that this description of the black hole interior involves what's called a state-dependent map between bulk observables inside the black hole and boundary observables. The way these paradoxes are resolved is that on one hand, you have a space of boundary operators. So these are some operators O, and they live on time on the boundary and some spatial directions on the boundary. And then there are bulk operators, which have an additional radial index associated with them. Just one second. And the resolution to these paradoxes comes about by giving it's an explicit map, but it's a map which depends on the microstate of the black hole. So the relationship between the boundary and the bulk depends on the microstate of the black hole. If you're willing to accept this feature, then you resolve all of these paradoxes these modern versions of the information paradox. And so the question in this talk really is a question about whether such a feature is consistent, because you might be worried that if you have two quantum theories and you have a state-dependent mapping between them, you know, where operators in one theory are related to operators in the other theory and the map between them depends on the microstate of the theory, you might be worried that it would, you might run into contradictions with the linearity of quantum mechanics. And so the question in this talk is whether this is consistent. So the firewall, the firewall proposal, so there are many versions of the firewall proposal. Some less precise and some more precise. When I say that, I mean that if you look at the most precise versions of the firewall proposal that stand up to some serious scrutiny, they really turn into the statement that in holography, you cannot describe the black hole interior. And if you cannot describe the black hole interior, then after that, then there's an additional statement which is like, the interior doesn't exist, or something else happens, or whatever. But really, the sharpest statements that exist in the firewall literature, and I'll actually review some of them, are the statements that you cannot describe the black hole interior holography. There are many other statements that exist in the literature, but none of them stand up to any scrutiny. But this is a statement which I think is an interesting statement. Yeah, but there's no argument anywhere that effective field, there's no direct argument anywhere that effective field theory breaks down. The argument is that if you can't describe the interior of the black hole, then you can postulate whatever you like existed. So, you know, there's one argument which is a sharp argument, which says that, if you try to describe the operators in the interior of the black hole in a full theory of quantum gravity, then we would run into various problems. After that, then the statement is, so we can postulate it's a firewall or a fuzzball or whatever we like. There's no evidence for that second part of the statement, right? I think this is something the firewall people would hopefully agree with. So there's a question of whether you can describe the interior of the black hole in a theory of quantum gravity, and whether such an interior exists for a generic state. And that's the sharp part of the statement. You know, the additional parts, whether there's a fuzzball or a firewall or so on, are just words that you add on after that, because you say your description breaks down, and so you know you can say, yeah. What is still a question? I'm trying to represent the argument of the firewall. I'm not saying that you cannot. As I said, the statement is that you can if you use the state-dependent map between the interior and the between the boundary and the bulk. And then the question is whether this is consistent. Okay. In response to these proposals that we had about state-dependent maps, there was Marolf and Pulchinski in a paper last year tried to come up with a problem for these state-dependent maps. And the specific problem they came was related to this issue of the linearity of quantum mechanics I mentioned. And their point was that if you have this kind of a state-dependent construction of the black hole interior, then this construction would violate a general rule of statistical mechanics, which I'll try and review. And the general rule of statistical mechanics is that if you have low energy excitations in a large thermal system, then low energy excitations in a large thermal system have a small effect on observables, and I'll make all of these statements precise. So the statement is roughly that if you walk into this room, it's a large thermal system, and you make a low energy excitation which has energy less than kT, then this room has a lot of energy, and therefore you can prove a theorem, which I'll review for you, which says that it's very hard to distinguish the new state after you've acted with this excitation from the earlier state. And the claim was that these state-dependent constructions might violate this property. And I'll try and describe in this talk a resolution to this paradox, which says that actually these violations are unobservable, and they're unobservable due to causality, and it's a rather non-trivial property of some AdS position space correlation functions, which comes out of some calculation, that tells you that actually even though naively you might have thought that these resolutions exist, no observer can actually observe them because of causality. So that's the summary of the resolution I'll try and describe. Okay, so this is a outline of my talk. Yeah. Well, you could not. You could certainly pose other problems. I mean, there's no. I mean, I don't know if you're saying, are there other questions that people, I mean, is there a very well-developed theory of state-dependent operators? There isn't. And so in some sense, you know, if someone points out an inconsistency, you try and resolve that. But there is, you could always come up with other problems and other versions of the information. So that's unknown. let me just give you an outline of this. Since there are many people here who may not be familiar with this discussion, I want to review by talking about the information paradox as you've seen it, which is the old information paradox. And then I'll talk about why it turns into a question about holography and the black hole interior in its precise versions. And then I'll talk about this paradox of low energy excitations resolution. Okay, so it's the old information paradox. So here's the information paradox says, many of you have seen it. Okay, so this is how it's described often in textbooks. This is an AdS version. So you know you have anti-de Sitter space. Anti-de Sitter, because we like to work with anti-de Sitter space because we believe we have a definition of holography. The same paradox goes through in flat space. So the statement is, you know, you inject some matter in from the boundary of AdS. This is the boundary. This matter, this is the surface of a star. It goes and collapses. This red line is the singularity. And then you look at physics much after the matter has gone through in this blue patch, the shaded patch called P. And in the shaded patch, the physics is independent of the details of the collapse. It doesn't know what kind of matter you put in. For example, if you look at, you know, correlation functions of some, you can take the field here and decompose it into modes. And these correlation functions have a thermal spectrum. This was Hawking's calculation to point out that these two-point functions have a thermal spectrum. But if these two-point functions here have the same thermal spectrum, then this suggests that whatever collapse you have, you always get, you know, a thermal spectrum up here. And so, you know, you have input A, you have a black hole, you get black body radiation. Input B, you have a black hole, you get black body radiation. And that looks like it's violating, you know, the reversibility of quantum mechanics. So that's the old information paradox. Okay. But actually, if you think about this a little more, this is not really a paradox, because very small corrections of the order of e to the minus s can restore unitarity. I guess this was realized by many people. It was pointed out rather sharply 15 years ago by Maldacena, but perhaps even earlier. And the statement is that, you know, a pure density matrix is one with squares to itself, can be such so that for almost all observables A alpha, almost, you know, all effective field theory observables A alpha, the expectation values of these observables in a pure density matrix are the same as the expectation values in a thermal density matrix, which is e to the minus beta h by z. Okay? And this is something you can just check in many, many, many systems. You know, thermal states and generic pure states look the same. And another way of saying this is that if you give me the thermal density matrix, which is e to the minus beta h by z, I add to it a very small correction, which is e to the minus s, where s is the entropy of the system at the temperature beta, into some correction matrix. You can engineer this correction so that rho pure square is rho pure, which is the statement it's pure, whereas clearly this thermal density matrix is not pure. So the purity or non-purity of a density matrix is a very fine-grained question. It's not something that you can ask unless you know exactly everything about the system. So the purity or non-purity of a density matrix is a very fine-grained question. And therefore, you know, very small corrections can restore unitarity to Hawking radiation. What is more, you know, so clearly Hawking's original calculation is imprecise enough, you know, to give you a paradox. Sometimes people try and, you know, compute corrections. They say, oh, we'll compute 1 over s corrections to Hawking radiation, and then we'll see if there's a paradox. But in fact, this is a program that's doomed from the start, because effective field theory cannot control these e to the minus s corrections. And as Sudeep pointed out in his talk, the reason for that is that when you look at, you know, any effective field theory computation you do, really what you should be doing in the theory of quantum gravity is integrating over all metrics. But, you know, when you really do a correlation function like the correlation function that Hawking calculated of, you know, of some field set at late times, you're working in a given saddle point of this, you know, of this complicated path integral over metrics. And then you do an expansion about some saddle point and you compute some answer, which is the answer that Hawking computed. But there could be other saddle points in this path integral that you will never see at any order in perturbation theory unless you can deal with gravity in a fully non-perturbative way. And any expansion that you do is an asymptotic series expansion about this. And what is more, non-perturbatively, the notion of locality that you had in your original space-time breaks down completely. So in fact, Maldacena pointed out in this case that, you know, with the black hole saddle point, there's another saddle point which is just a thermal ADS saddle point. That's subleading, but if you start asking questions at e to the minus s accuracy, that other saddle point contributes. So, you know, it's not just that Hawking's calculation is imprecise, but efforts to correct Hawking's calculation by, you know, computing back reaction and so on are also not sufficient to give you a paradox. So, for example, and this is something that Sudeep pointed out, one thing that could happen, one of the assumptions that goes into this Hawking paradox and also more recent versions of Hawking's paradox like this strong subadditivity paradox of Mathur, was that you divide spacetime into three regions, you know, A, which is a region, asymptotic region far away, some zone region near the horizon B, and some region just behind the horizon, which is C. But if you look at an S-point correlator, where S is the entropy of this black hole, then this is a naive way of saying it, but you know, the commutator of an operator outside in this A and an operator inside in this C on a single space-like slice might not vanish if it's sandwiched in an S-point correlation function. This is a statement that locality breaks down for correlation functions which are extremely high point. And in fact, in empty ADS, you can see this very concretely. Just in even in empty ADS, this is not something that's specific to black holes. It's the statement that if you start probing space-time at too many points, as Sudeep also mentioned in his talk, you know, notions of locality and statements you can prove using, you know, the usual analyticity properties of S matrix simply cease to hold. And in empty ADS, you can explicitly see that you can write the interior of some region which is, you know, interior of some operators at some point, in terms of a very complicated collection of operators, all of which are space-like separated from that point. Which is telling you that if you look at very high point correlators, the factorization of the Hilbert space into, you know, some degrees of freedom here and some degrees of freedom here just breaks down. And this is something you can just see in empty areas. No, S-point correlator. You don't need an E to the S-point correlator, you just need an S-point correlator. So in empty ADS, you need an in-point correlator. You know, alternately, you could look at a two-point function at accuracy e to the minus s. But you, or you can look at an S-point correlator at the leading connected part. So this is, we use the Riesch-Leiter theorem. The Riesch-Leiter theorem is something slightly separate. It's a statement that, you know, acting with all operators in a certain region, you can generate everything. In fact, we use the generalization of the Riesch-Leiter theorem here, but it's not the same statement. In ordinary quantum field theory, this never happens. In ordinary quantum field theory, you always have exact locality. Operators here, it's constructed that way. Operators here commute with operators somewhere else. It's only in quantum gravity that you would expect something like this to happen. In fact, we use this exact locality on the boundary to prove this feature in the bulk. So, you know, in AdS CFT, the way it works is there's some locality on the boundary and you can use that. That's right, so that's what we use. We use some Riesch-Leiter in the time domain for, just to prove this result. That's how you got this example. But Riesch-Leiter is really not relevant. Riesch-Leiter is saying something different. It's saying that the space of all states you get by acting with a set of operators in a compact space is actually dense in the full Hilbert space. That's different. So Riesch-Leiter is a statement that the vacuum is what's called, you know, separating. And it's cyclic, so that's different. So ordinary quantum field theory, you don't see these. So this example that we had is an example we had in empty ADS. But you know, if you generally want to ask, what is quantum gravity in empty ADS? What does that mean? It's, there you have some theory. You're quantizing. Your background, you're quantizing, you know, metric fluctuations and string degrees of fluctuations about that. That's it. Actually, we've established something stronger, which is that phi of x in can be written as a combination of phi of x out, where the combination is explicit. So a statement is that, so this, of course, is a corollary of that. Okay. So the bottom line is, and this is something I'd like everyone to take away, is that Hawking's calculation is not precise enough to lead to a paradox and cannot be made precise enough to lead to a paradox. And sometimes there are still papers that say, you know, we don't know the loophole in Hawking's calculation. That's simply not true. Hawking's calculation is just not precise enough to lead to a paradox. And this is something about which there is not so much evidence. Okay, so now what is the paradox? Where do you get a paradox? You get a paradox, as I'll try and show you, when you try and describe the interior of a black hole holographically. Okay, so, the paradox I want to persuade you, the precise version of the paradox is, can the black hole interior be described holographically? And a priori, you might think this is very different from the information paradox. So the information paradox has something to do with reversibility of quantum mechanics, and this is some question about holography, and why is this relevant to the information paradox? The reason they're related is that, you know, this question also becomes an interesting question precisely because you get a contradiction between some general properties that you expect from the unitarity of the field theory, the holographic field theory on the boundary, and some general properties you expect to get from effective field theory in the bulk. And remember, that's how Hawking's paradox initially was defined. It was defined by saying, effective field theory in the bulk gives you thermal radiation, and unitarity tells you you have to have reversibility. So there's a contradiction between unitarity and effective field theory. As I pointed out, in that setup, it can't be made precise because you can have very small e to the minus s corrections. But I'll show you another setup in which this clash can be made sharper and cannot be so easily resolved with e to the minus s corrections. Okay, so let me just try and tell you how this goes. I'll try and be brief. You see, if you try to describe the interior of a horizon, so I've zoomed in, so this is a black hole horizon, this brown line, and I've zoomed into the black hole horizon. When you zoom into the black hole horizon, you find that you need, you know, to describe the degrees of freedom inside, you need both left movers and right movers. So you need these little blue arrows and these little purple arrows, both inside and outside the horizon. While the left-moving degrees of freedom from outside the horizon continue smoothly, the color is not sharp enough, otherwise they're the same color. the right moving degrees of freedom you need inside are new degrees of freedom. Now, some of you, anyone who's read Hawking's original paper, will actually know about this, because Hawking in his original paper talked about these modes that have bounced off the origin of polar coordinates. So if you've read Hawking's paper, he had these light rays that had bounced off the origin of polar coordinates, which were entangled with the light rays outside. And these degrees of freedom you need, these O tilde degrees of freedom, which are the light, which are the right movers behind the horizon, are those. Alternately, you, if you like to think of eternal black holes, you can think of these degrees of freedom behind the horizon as coming from the left asymptotic region of the eternal black hole. Whatever way you like to think of them, the fact is that you need these degrees of freedom so as to get a local effective field theory near the horizon. Okay. What is more, just effective field theory, just demanding that you have effective field theory and smooth correlation functions, about the horizon, gives you some conditions on how these left movers O's and these right movers O tilde have to behave. And the conditions you get are conditions you can write down precisely. They're conditions that tell you that the two-point functions of these right movers and of the left movers have to be thermal. These C factors you can ignore. There are some commutative factors because these guys are not canonically normalized. And, you know, there's some KMS condition that tells you that the commutator itself is related to the two-point function. So these are this is the statement that these two guys have to behave in a thermal way, which is really Hawking's derivation. You know, Hawking pointed out that effective field theory implies these conditions. But you can, you know, and it's just the same statement, that these left and right movers have to have a particular entanglement if the horizon is to be smooth. Okay. And there's some conditions you can write down. The details of these conditions are not important. The summary just is, you need degrees of freedom behind the horizon and in front of the horizon, that you need some different degrees of freedom behind the horizon, and those different degrees of freedom in a typical state have to be entangled in a particular way with the degrees of freedom in front. What is the entanglement? You can write down precisely. You can write down equations that tell you how the two-point functions have to be. Okay, and I can tell you how to derive these, but the beta is temperature of the horizon. This is all a near horizon analysis. Beta is order one quantity. It's neither very small nor very. I mean, this is not the temperature as measured by some observer who's hovering. This is the surface gravity of the horizon. This is that beta. This beta is, I mean, this it measures at infinity. That's right. This is the temperature measured. I mean, this is the statement you have a Rindler, you have two Rindler wedges, they have a certain entanglement which is related to a temperature measure. Okay. Now, what is the argument? So now let me try. So the question is, can you describe these O tilde operators in the conformal field theory? You could ask, can you describe these O operators? And the answer is yes, and there's a standard construction, which I won't review. But let me just try and give you a flavor of what problems arise if you try to describe these O tilde operators in the CST. So the problem that arises is as follows. Okay? So you do an analysis, you look at large diffeomorphisms in the spacetime. Okay? So large diffeomorphisms are things which shift the boundary of AdS. These large diffeomorphisms tell you that the Hamiltonian of the boundary theory has to have a particular commutator with these right moving degrees of freedom, which in fact tells you that they have to have the wrong energy. So remember, we often say in Hawking's analysis that the modes behind the horizon have negative energy with respect to the asymptotic Hamiltonian. This is that statement. If you do a large diffeomorphism on the boundary, which shifts times on the boundary, that's generated by the Hamiltonian. And you know, you can see how these modes behind the horizon that I described transform. And they transform in this way, so that the annihilation operator has positive energy. And you're familiar with this from the colloquial statement that the radiation behind the horizon or the particles behind the horizon have the opposite energy. So that's this statement precisely. Remember I said before that there's a particular condition on the two-point functions. This two-point function condition is the statement that they have to behave thermally. And that can be translated into a statement that the annihilation into creation is related to the creation into annihilation two-point function with some factor of e to the beta omega. Was there a question? So these are just conditions. This came from the previous slide, and this came from large diffeomorphisms. But if the black hole is approximately thermal, okay, and this is where I'm going to use unitarity on the boundary, then this two-point function, which is the one I had here, is related to a thermal two-point function. Okay, so I can replace this state psi with a thermal trace. Then I can use cyclicity of the trace to take this O dagger through, come on this side. Then I can use the commutator of O dagger with H that I had here to get some factor. And in fact, I find I have the opposite factor. Okay? So O into O dagger turns out to be e to the minus omega into O dagger into O, whereas it should have been e to the plus beta omega into O dagger into O. So you find you have the opposite factor. So what I've used here is just a statement that in the boundary CFT, this is where I put in boundary data and just general considerations, I can replace, you know, expectation values in a pure state, which looks thermal by thermal expectation values, and I've used cyclicity of the trace. Okay? And that's the statement, that, and then I found a result that looks like it's in contradiction with the result that you want from effective field theory in the bulk. So this is giving you a general contradiction between effective field theory requirements, that's the second line, and general requirements from cyclicity of the trace and general requirements that you expect from operators in the bulk. And this is the statement that, that the firewall people used to argue that the O tildes therefore don't exist in the CFT, or at least there are no O tildes that have this correct property in the CFT. Smoothness across the horizon. This equation, that's right. Well, if this is true, then these, well, okay, so second equation you write is smoothness inside the horizon. There's also a related equation which is O tilde with O, which gives you across the horizon. The second equation purely is smoothness inside the horizon. That's So this is the kind of arguments. There are many others. I'm just giving you one. There are several other arguments. There's a multiplicity of such arguments, all of which go along similar lines, which is what was used to show that, you know, you can't have these O tilde operators in the CFT, and therefore the interior doesn't exist. Okay? And you can see these arguments are harder to resolve with e to the minus s corrections, because there's an order one contradiction. You're getting e to the minus beta, whereas you should have got e to the plus beta. So, you know, if I change this state with some e to the minus s corrections, I won't turn this e to the minus beta into e to the plus beta. Okay? So that's how these versions of the information paradox are made sharp. Okay. So now, what is the resolution? Resolution really is that you shouldn't have used the trace. Okay, so I'm going to say that you shouldn't have used the cyclicity of the trace. I'll try and describe what that means. So the way this construction works is that you recognize that these operators O tilde are really defined about a particular microstate. So what more precisely, what that means is that you take a particular microstate psi, and then you look at a set of a small Hilbert space, this is this H psi, which is a subset of the big Hilbert space, which is the set of all effective field theory excitations about that particular microstate. And then you declare that you're going to work only within that particular microstate. All physical experiments are restricted to that particular microstate, to that particular, you know, subspace of the full Hilbert space. For those of you who followed these quantum error correction discussions, this H psi is H code, is what the quantum error correction community calls H code. For those of you who haven't ignored this last. Now, within this subspace, they're not defined over the full Hilbert space. They're defined over a particular neighborhood of the microstate of the black hole that you're in. So the statement is, Good. So that's the question. So the statement right now is you have an infalling observer who's falling into the black hole, which is in a given microstate. He can't access the full Hilbert space, so you define effective field theory by looking at a neighborhood of the microstate that he's falling into, which is the neighborhood of the Hilbert space that he can actually excite. I'll talk about the global things a little later. That's the rest. Okay. Yeah, it's a Hilbert space. It's a linear Hilbert space. No, little Hilbert space is a linear subspace of the full space. No, it's not a dense domain. It's just a subspace inside the. It's not dense. Okay. Within this little Hilbert space, you can define these operators, these O tilde operators. We had a certain definition, which actually I won't review right now, which actually was related to this, this isomorphism used in this Tomita Takesaki theory of von Neumann algebras. But anyway, within this little Hilbert space, there's a particular way of defining these O tilde operators. And if you accept this, then you can use these O tilde operators to construct the local field behind the horizon. And this is a linear operator on this little Hilbert space at psi, and it has all the correct behaviors within effective field theory. Okay. But it's not a linear operator on the full Hilbert space. So the question is, how does it look like on the full Hilbert space? On the full Hilbert space, you take the full Hilbert space and you have to divide it up into many H psi's, some of which might even overlap, and then you have to demand that things agree on that overlap. But you divide it up into many little H psi's, and there's no single linear operator O tilde that behaves correctly in all the H psi's. But state dependence is a statement that you might have to use different operators O tilde in different edge size. So globally, this operator doesn't have a good global structure, but the statement is that if you're in a given microstate, then bulk locality and bulk effective field theory emerges about that given microstate, and about that given microstate, you can define a set of good operators in which bulk effective field theory holds. But if you try to do, you know, experiments which go beyond effective field theory, then these operators don't have any meaning any longer. And you know, if you insert a huge amount of energy in the black hole, you go to a different microstate, or you do something else which is very perverse to go to an entirely different microstate outside the domain of effective field theory, then you need to redefine your degrees of freedom that you're using. So the statement is that no operator O tilde, you can't find any operator O tilde that behaves correctly globally. That was the indication I gave you previously. That's right. So there's no global operator. So really, this operator O tilde has to behave like the entanglement entropy, or something which has some nonlinear properties in the full Hilbert space, but nonlinear in such a way that you can't observe that in any experiment. You know, in any experiment, if you only do effective field theory experiments about a given microstate, that nonlinearity has to be completely unobserved. So that's what this O tilde is doing. So it's a nonlinear operator viewed globally, but in such a way that no observer can observe that nonlinearity. Are they unbounded operators or bounded? We always like to put cutoffs for us. Everything is bounded. But you can ask more. But we always like to put cutoffs on our Hilbert space and restrict energy and so on. So for us, this is never a question which we consider seriously. If you pushed me a lot, I would put a cutoff on the total energy and I'd make all these operators bounded operators, acting within the finite Hilbert. That's correct. I mean, maybe we can generalize everything to infinite dimensional Hilbert spaces, but we always like to think in terms of finite dimensional Hilbert spaces. Fine, I have no objection to this, but to doing things in infinite dimensional Hilbert space, but I just like to put cutoffs, so this distinction between bounded and unbounded is never important for anything we do here. Maybe we're just not being careful enough, but yeah. Yes, answer is that they're all bounded. We'll put cutoffs on total energy because these edge size are bounded, they're finite Hilbert spaces. You put cutoffs in the, you say effective field theory experiments are those that you can generate with, you know, excitations of finite energy and a finite number of excitations. So there's a, you know, polynomial algebra, which is a finite polynomial algebra of local operators, and that is what you define as effective field theory. And edge size, the action of that polynomial algebra on a state, and then all these operators O tilde act only with net size, so they're all bounded. Okay, so now if you accept this state dependence, it resolves all of these paradoxes. The way it resolves the paradox I showed you, by the way, is that you can't use the cyclicity of the trace for operators O tilde of this kind. Okay? So whenever you try to do a trace, then these very small nonlinear terms, which are in some sense e to the minus s nonlinearities in these operators, become important, and you can't do these traces. But within this Hilbert space, they look perfectly good. And it has the state dependence, this is what I call state dependence, the fact that you can't define these globally, but you have to define them patch by patch in the Hilbert space. No, the trace, you see, this trace I was taking was a trace on the full Hilbert space. Okay. So this operator O tilde, this O tilde is not defined in the full Hilbert space. This O tilde dagger is defined in the subspace of the full Hilbert space. So the O tilde dagger, if you view it in the full Hilbert space, even if it's finite, has different definitions in different patches. So viewed in the whole Hilbert space, it's a nonlinear kind of operator. So if you do that, then this trace is, then you can't. When you sum over all operators, you should be putting a psi there. You should really be summing with O tilde on that particular edge psi. This expression, yeah, so you can't take the trace over operators of this kind. You know, if you start taking the trace over, it's the proof, for example, that entanglement entropy can't be described by linear operator. So that, I'm not using some funny thing about infinities. I'm simply saying that the operator is not defined globally. So you shouldn't take a trace and assume you have the same operator as you go over different microstates. As you go over different microstates, the operator, physical operator that you're using is changing. No, but not all, nonlinear operators are not of that kind. You know, you can always define operators which are maps from the Hilbert space back to itself, which are not matrices. The Hilbert space in finite dimensions is also CPN. Not all functions in CPN you can write as that. So these are operators which are defined, which are linear functions on a subspace of CPN, but not all functions from CPN to CPN you can write as matrices. Okay, so operators you can write as, these are not linear operators in a full Hilbert space. These are linear only within your effective field theory Hilbert. Then you don't get the paradox. The paradox only arises if you take the trace, you know. I can show you later. The paradox doesn't arise if you take the trace only on that subspace. The paradox arises if you try and take the trace on the full set. Yeah, there's a unitary transformation that will map the operators from one batch to another batch. Yeah, it has to be unitary. Okay, so now, rest of the talk. Okay, I'll try and do it fast. So what's the rest of the talk? Rest of the talk is about these consistency questions that people have been asking. So now, you know, I claimed here that these observable, these nonlinearities are basically unobservable, so you can get away with them. And it's a statement in a sense that the bulk spacetime emerges, and it emerges after you've given more information. After you've told me what microstate of the CFT you're in, then the bulk spacetime emerges. Okay. Now the question is, can you do some complicated experiments that could detect a problem with this kind of a setup? So Marolf and Pulchinski came up with an argument, which I'll try and review for you. The statement is that, roughly, that if you take a low energy excitation in some quantum system, which is an excitation of, by low energy, I mean the following. You take the Hamiltonian, you take the transformation of the Hamiltonian under a unitary operator. You compare this expectation with the original expectation, and this I define as delta E. So low energy excitation is going to be given by a unitary operator U, which inserts an energy delta E into the system. Okay? Then the statement is, and this is a theorem, that for any operator A alpha, any linear operator A alpha, of course, you can find that U A alpha U dagger minus, so the change of A alpha under the action of U is bounded by the same delta E into beta into some factor sigma alpha, which is this standard deviation of this operator A alpha, which just sets the scale of A alpha. So the statement is the change in the expectation value of an operator is bounded by the change in the energy that the unitary inserts into the system. Okay, and this is true for any linear operator. How do you prove this? I won't go through the proof since I'm running out of time, but roughly the proof says that, you know, the dimension of the Hilbert spaces at E and E plus delta E are very close. They're related, the ratio of the dimensions is E to the beta delta E. Okay, this should have been beta delta E, not beta E. And therefore, you can decompose any state at the higher energy in terms of the image of a state at the lower energy plus some orthogonal subspace. And because the state at the higher energy has the same temperature, you see, by inserting an energy delta E, you don't change the temperature. You change the temperature only by 1 by N if you insert an energy delta E. That's why you know that this expectation value is the same as this expectation value. But you also know, you know, and then you can just relate this expectation value to the change in the operator under U, and you get this beta delta E factor. Okay. You can go through the proof later, but it's not so hard to. Okay. So you have this theorem, and this theorem has a statement in words. It says that it's impossible to definitively excite a large thermal system with energy less than kT. And that's the statement. If you put an energy much less than kT, so beta delta E is much smaller than 1, you don't change the expectation value of any operator by too much in a thermal system. This is just a statement in statistical mechanics. Okay, but Marolf and Pulchinski said, oh look, but your operators, these state-dependent operators, violate this, and so you will see, you know, an observer could do an experiment to see that these operators have a problem. They're behaving differently from normal operators. And the way this argument goes is, remember I said that there had to be a two-point function between the inside and the outside. So I've talked about two-point functions of inside and inside. But there's also a two-point function of the annihilation operators inside with the annihilation operators outside. So O tilde two-point function. Then they said, let's do a phase rotation. So the phase rotation is a rotation by the number operator outside. Okay? O dagger. So this is a number operator outside. This phase rotation, if you smear these number operators a little bit, you don't want to think of infinite number operators. If you smear them a little bit, has a very small energy, because remember that, you know, number operators approximately commute with the Hamiltonian. But the phase rotation rotates the phase of this operator, but doesn't touch this operator. So it takes this operator, this two-point function, into something which is itself into e to the I theta. So the change in the two-point function under the action of this unitary is order one, because it's e to the I theta minus one into this prefactor. But the change in the energy is arbitrarily low. It's just theta squared into delta omega squared, where delta omega is just controlled by how much you smeared these modes. Okay. And so by rotating the phase of these at very low cost in energy, it looks like, you know, you can violate this general theorem of statistical mechanics. Okay, here's a colloquial way of saying it. So if you don't want to follow this and correlators, here's one more way to say it. For every black hole which has an empty interior, you know, and you have this construction that gives you this empty interior, add an ultra-relativistic shell just behind the horizon. So this is your firewall. It's an ultra-relativistic shell of matter that's hugging the horizon, that's staying very close to the horizon, so it has to be expanding at the speed of light. So for a local observer, it's very, very high energy. It's ultra-relativistically expanding. But the global EDM energy of such a shell is almost zero. That's because you can compute that the binding energy of this shell with the black hole cancels off its kinetic energy. This is just a simple classical computation you can do. So you can have these ultra-relativistic firewalls that live very close to the horizon that affect a local observer very strongly, but that have very small global ADM energy. And these phase shift operators of Malolf and Polchinski are just trying to create these operators, you know, these ultra-relativistic shells. And this is a paradox that exists only inside the horizon. Sorry, let me skip this. To get to this paradox, you have to cross the horizon, otherwise you don't see it. I can explain that later. Let me just try, in my 3 minutes that are left, to summarize the resolution. Okay? So the resolution to this paradox, which is what I described in this last paper, is the following. So start with some equilibrium state psi, and we all agree that this is a, you know, empty black hole. And now you try to create this firewall by changing the CFT Hamiltonian. So you turn on a source that will try to create this firewall. And then after you turn on a source, you then jump in and try to measure, you know, whether you saw this anomalously large effect in correlation functions across the horizon. So the statement is, within effective field theory, let's try and see if you can engineer this experiment where you turn on a source that will create this firewall, and then you jump in and you see if you have this anomalously large deviation of correlators across the horizon. And the statement is that no observer can do this. In fact, as a result of causality, basically, as I'll describe to you, you know, the change in all observables is bounded by precisely this factor, beta delta E, where delta E is the energy inserted by the source. And this is not something that's obvious. It follows as a very non-trivial property of AdS correlators, but ensures that, you know, this construction that we have is consistent, because no observer can actually observe this violation of this basic property of statistics. Okay, so in fact, you can prove a slightly stronger result, and that's why the causal patch comes in the title. In fact, the causal patch has a little more, which I won't mention in this talk. It's actually the following statement. Let's say you do this experiment in AdS, but you think carefully about the position dependence of the observables. So remember, this statement is a statement about the change in the expectation values of some observables A under some unitary U. If you think carefully about the position dependence of the unitary U and the observable A, and you ensure that they fit in the same causal patch. So when you have black holes, you can define causal patches. Not everything lives in the same causal patch. Then, in fact, you can prove that this bound is satisfied. And this, in fact, is the same. It's actually stronger than the previous result for a very simple reason. You know, if you modify the CFT Hamiltonian with a source, then all operators, Heisenberg operators, get modified in this way with some combination of anti-time ordered and time-ordered products. But, you know, for any observer in the bulk, only the part of the source that's in the causal patch of that observer can affect him, just by causality. And if you have an observer somewhere in the bulk, he can't know about the part of the source that's space-like to him. He can only know about the part of the source that exists, you know, on the boundary in the past light cone of that observer. Therefore, if you can prove the statement for causal patches and unitaries, then you've also proved the statement for sources. In fact, you've proved a little more. Okay, so this is what a causal patch looks like. This is actually half of an eternal black hole. A causal patch is specified by some point on the boundary, and you know, you have some observer who lives in this causal patch, so he ends his life at this point on the boundary, and you know, you can act with any unit. He's only sensitive to unitary excitations that act up till this point on the boundary. He's not sensitive to anything that goes on. So if you can prove that this inequality of statistical mechanics holds, even with our state-dependent operators within this causal patch, then you have proved the consistency, at least as far as this paradox goes. Okay, so I'm out of time, but let me just quickly try and say this. I already said, you know, if you can prove this, then you've basically proved that this is unobservable. Okay, so I won't, let me just take one minute. Basically, there's some technical proof of this inequality. And the technical proof of this inequality basically involves taking these tilde operators and writing them as some, you know, as some, well, these tilde operators, the action of these tilde operators, apart from the fact that they commute with everything else, can always be written as the action of ordinary operators. And the technical part is to show that these phi hat operators, okay, sorry, I'm going to skip the technical part of the proof. There's some, I don't have time to do that. There's a technical proof, and the main part of that proof is to prove that a certain commutator vanishes. And that commutator vanishes as a result of some other beautiful properties of modes in anti-de Sitter space and the analytic properties. But there's some, you can prove that a particular commutator vanishes. And therefore, in fact, you know, as far as unitary excitations of this kind are concerned, which are in the same causal patch as the observer, these operators phi tilde, as a result of this vanishing of the commutator, behave very close to ordinary operators, precisely up to corrections of this order beta delta e that we were allowed to have. Okay. So this I'll skip. So let me just say this. So, you know, just to say, the way this paradox was formulated, the way I showed it to you a couple of slides earlier, was in frequency space. You know, it said you have a certain two-point function of modes in frequency space. It said O omega into O tilde omega has to have some form. And then I can act with some, you know, with some operator which rotates the phase of these modes in frequency space. And if I act with this operator and then I measure this O omega O tilde omega correlator, this is changed. So it's a frequency space paradox. But really, you should think, if you want to think carefully about the constraints of causality, you need to think carefully about what kind of unitary operators can generate this phase rotation and what you can measure after that. You know, you can't always measure two-point functions between frequency modes. You can turn on sources and then you can measure position space two-point functions. And because you're in AdS, you know, you don't have infinite time to measure anything that you like. And the statement is that, in fact, when you consider these restrictions of causality, these anomalous transformations of these correlators cancel as a result of some non-trivial property of AdS correlators. And therefore, these properties that could have suggested that state-dependent constructions of the interior were anomalous or inconsistent actually are not visible in any physical experiment. Okay? Okay, so I'm almost done. I'll just take 1 minute and summarize what I said. I said the modern information paradox can be rephrased as a question about the existence of certain CFT operators that describe the interior. And this can also be resolved by using a state-dependent map between bulk and boundary fields. The question then is whether state dependence is consistent. There was an argument that by Marolf and Pulchinski saying state dependence is not consistent, and the way it violates the linearity of quantum mechanics, the way this is visible, is by testing this statistical inequality that you can define for all linear operators, which tells you about the change in the expectation value of an operator A. But I've pointed out that this paradox is unobservable because if you consider the constraints of causality so that this excitation and the observable both fit in the same causal patch, then in fact this inequality is obeyed from a very non-trivial calculation. Okay, so what's the open question? The open question is that this shows, up to other consistency conditions that someone might find as you ask, this shows that it is possible, at least so far, to describe this black hole interior holographically and consistently. But I think the main question which I'll end with is that this doesn't answer the question of why this is the correct description. You know, in some sense, you'd want a dynamical answer for why an infalling observer picks out these state-dependent observers. And I think this is an interesting question because, you know, this is the answer, kind of answer you want here is analogous to this unruh debate answer for why a particular observer chooses a particular particle number as convenient. And, you know, their answer was based on some coupling between the field and the detector. The physical model of the detector. Here you're trying to ask why a particular observer uses a particular local field operator phi in the set of all operators in this CFT. And I think this is an interesting question which hasn't attracted enough attention. Why is it that we use the degrees of freedom that we do in the full Hilbert space of quantum gravity, whatever it is? Why do we choose to describe the world in terms of particular field operators and what picks out those field operators? I think this is the interesting question that we should talk about. Sorry, I've gone over time. Yeah. Actually, it's all figured out to leading order in 1 over n. So there's alpha prime, and also you could ask, you know, how all this works if you try to do subleading orders in 1 over n. You know, if you try to, so this construction that we have is all a leading order construction, because the paradoxes and so on are all phrased at the level of two-point functions, which basically are free field theory computations done in the background space time. That's not leading 1 over n, that's kind of order 1. That's what I'd call order 1. You can then ask leading 1 over n, and you could also ask leading alpha prime. This has not been... You're right also that string theory has somehow not appeared here, so alpha prime has not appeared here. But loops have also not been considered, so 1 over n has not been considered. And I don't know what to say about that. That's an analysis that has not been done. In fact, Daniel Harlow tried to...